Jane was most likely born in Wolfhall, Wiltshire, the daughter of Sir John Seymour and Marjorie Wentworth. She lacked the education that Catherine of Aragon and Anne Boleyn, Henry's first and second wives, possessed, and she had a limited ability to read and write, but excelled at needlework and household management, which were deemed more appropriate for women. Jane was Queen Catherine's maid of honour in 1532, but she may have served the monarch as early as 1527, and then continued to serve with her sister Elizabeth during Queen Anne's reign. But Henry became besotted, he caught a glimpse of Jane, and it was one that he had overlooked in previous encounters. Henry demonstrated an inability to draw on prior experiences. Nevertheless, Henry took a shine to this lady on this occasion. Jane was modest, compassionate and caring, all of which Henry couldn't figure out as to why she was so different to others from his past. But she was also blessed with beauty, not that his previous wives lacked it, but there was something special about Jane that Henry couldn't quite pin down. Although Jane was not openly defended by everyone in court, Chapuis described her as being of average stature and extremely pale. He also described her as being unattractive. However, Henry was undeterred, and his interest in Jane was first reported in February 1536, approximately 3 months before Anne Boleyn was executed. If there was anything negative to say about Jane, it was her timing in accepting Henry into her life, marrying the man whose wife he had murdered only 24 hours earlier. Perhaps Henry, well known as a royal tyrant, used his affinity for erasing history and convincing Jane it was time to move on. Despite Anne Boleyn's death, Jane would be found at Wolfhall getting ready for her wedding to the king. Henry reportedly told Jane that his ex-wife was worthless, that there was no time to waste in forming this new union.
It may sound bizarre, but Jane may have simply gone along for the ride and believed everything she was now being told. While the entire saga is tragic, it was no more so than telling the story of every other woman who had become involved with this man in some way.
Jane appears to have felt little remorse for Henry's previous wife, Anne. She was the one who mattered now, and Anne was merely water under the bridge. This lady, who had previously been described as meek and mild, suddenly revealed a new exterior, one of resolve to achieve heights her previous adversaries could only dream of.
In reality, Jane was a passive character who would never follow Anne Boleyn's example, and her role was determined by the king's commands and whims. Interestingly, the mottos of Henry's wives tell their own story. Jane's was bound to obey and serve, whereas Anne's was me and mine.
On the 30th of May 1536, Bishop Gardiner married Henry and Jane at the Palace of Whitehall in London. As a wedding gift, he bestowed upon her 104 manors in four counties, as well as several forests and hunting chases in exchange for her jointure, which provided her with the necessary income during their marriage. On the 4th of June 1536, she was formally installed as Queen.
Jane conceived in January 1537. She then developed a craving for quail during her pregnancy, which Henry obtained from Calais and Flanders. Throughout the summer, she avoided public appearances and lived a relatively sedate existence, aided by the royal physicians and the best midwives in the kingdom.
Jane was then relocated to Hampton Court Palace. Her doctors and astrologers predicted a boy, but the birth was still a long way off, with numerous dangers ahead. However, she went into labour on October the 9th, but after 2 days of trying, Henry became concerned for her well-being, and he feared that history would repeat itself and the child would perish once more. However, good news arrived on the 12th of October 1537, when Jane gave birth to the coveted male heir, the future King Edward VI.
Edward was christened without his mother present on the 15th of October 1537, as was customary. He was Henry VIII's sole legitimate son who survived childhood, and even Mary and Elizabeth, Henry's daughters, were present and carried Edward's train during the ceremony. However, they do say that sorrow follows joy in the same way that night follows day.
The Queen had developed a chill on this occasion. Reports indicated that she had consumed some unsuitable food, which could have resulted in poisoning. And her diet at the time was probably not helping. Following Edward's birth, she continued to eat her favourite quail eggs and drink wine.
Jane's continuing difficulties are almost certainly the result of a number of factors. One is anemia, which may occur after delivery due to a lengthy labour. Dehydration from diarrhoea and prolonged bed rest, which resulted in an embolism. Probably more than just one of those symptoms, as one was not enough to instantly kill Jane, but enough to gradually put her into cardiorespiratory failure, shock, and eventually, without treatment, death. It's possible she was entering a stage of her limbs turning blue. This is based on her symptoms at the end, particularly the coldness she felt.
At last, there was reason for optimism when Jane began to feel better. Even now, proper hydration was critical, and it appeared as though she would pull through for the time being. However, following this brief respite, she began to relapse into pain. She began to feel short of breath, restless, and anxious. Her temperature had increased, and swelling could have occurred as a result of an oxygen deficiency. Jane was now in a delirious state as a result of kidney failure. She was confused and disorientated, gasping for air and slipping in and out of consciousness as the end drew near. Documents surrounding the birth are both sketchy and lack credence. In the final diagnosis of Jane, we can presume that she suffered with food poisoning. This would not have helped her overall recovery. However, it has been widely reported that she suffered with puerperal fever, but again, there's no evidence of this or puerperal sepsis, in which both have similar symptoms, a common cause of death for many women within the Tudor period. With that outcome not being mentioned in the final report, it should also be regarded with a sceptical view. Doctors in the 16th century knew very little medically, but they did recognise the same symptoms in others, which they would then report on. One further point noting is Jane could have been suffering with endometritis after giving birth. This would certainly have brought upon a swift deterioration, making it extremely doubtful she would have been strong enough to attend Edward's christening. There is no way of knowing or fully evaluating exactly what did cause her death. Most of the reports are very limited with information, and all we can do now is at best make an educated guess.
We can only imagine how Henry, the doctors and others present felt as they watched Jane's agony, helpless in the face of an illness they just didn't understand. The king held Jane's hand as she lay in bed and told her, "You must live, Jane, you must." But it wouldn't happen. The sights and sounds now started to wane. Jane's senses were gradually fading, becoming weaker with each breath. Her dreams and aspirations had come to an end, and with one last thought of happiness, her eyes closed for the final time.